Hello anatomy colleagues, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this dissection video, we will really get to start with the identification of the viscera associated with the gastrointestinal system and the abdomen. Make sure you have reviewed the names and general locations of the organs of the GI tube, so this way you are familiar at least with the terms that we're going to be talking about, and it'll really help as we work through this area. So we have much to do, so let's get started. All right, let's start with the viscera that is most superficial or easily accessible from an anterior view. Typically, for me, one of the most obvious things in this region is the small intestine, unless there is a noticeable amount of air in parts of the large intestine. The small intestine, which I'm just gonna circle some of the general area that we're looking at the small intestine. It tends to be a bit more towards the midline or a bit more medial, but of course it also will expand throughout the region. The duodenum, which is the most proximal portion of the small intestine, is typically a little bit deeper, so we won't see it in this more superficial dissection. The jejunum is going to be more in the left upper quadrant, whereas the ileum is going to be more in the right lower quadrant. And then as you can see, of course, it's going to extend into some of the other regions. We're not going to be able to look at this and just see where the jejunum transitions into the ileum. That's not grossly visible. But if we were to ask you to identify the jejunum, we would have to put it well in the left upper quadrant. Whereas if we were to ask about the ileum, we would have it closer to the cecum around that, more in terms of that right lower quadrant. So in general, just located in these regions right here, the small intestine is going to be smaller in caliber than portions of the large intestine. Now the ileum, as we know, is going to be connected to the cecum, which is the proximal most portion of the large intestine. It also tends to be one of the largest in caliber of the portions of the large intestine. This will continue into the ascending colon, which is a little difficult to see on this image because it's a bit more posteriorly positioned. And you can see some of the transverse colon here as it's been moved a little superiorly to kind of better show portions of its transverse mesocolon or its portion of the peritoneum there. I really like this image because it shows a relatively realistic representation of just how crowded this area is and how you often need to move structures around in order to better view more posteriorly placed or deeper structures. Okay, the duodeno-jejunal flexure is a little deeper. And so likely we won't see it very well in this particular session, but I do like this image because it shows it fairly nicely. I like to see the entirety of the duodenum. And the flexure is the border between the duodenum and the jejunum. And it's typically characterized, I'm going to kind of draw a line through about where it would be located. It's typically characterized by a fairly sharp turn inferiorly. So this would be duodenum. Kind of outlining this portion, that would be the duodenum. And then you would have the juncture right here, or the flexure. And then from there, you would get into the jejunum. We're going to discuss these different parts of the duodenum in an upcoming session, but this is a really nice picture for that. It also shows the really close relationship with the pancreas, particularly the head of the pancreas. Now, if you were to incise the small intestine, which we always advise one does with great care, as there may be contents within, you will see notable circular folds of the mucosa, which tend to be complete when we're talking about the small intestine. These tend to be more prominent in the more proximal portions of the jejunum, but are found throughout, except in the most terminal portions of the ileum. All right, let's focus in on the structures of the large intestine on this particular image. You can see a little bit of the small intestine here. We're going to follow the ileum to where it is going to join with the cecum. This right here would be referred to as the ileocecal junction. And the cecum is going to be that most proximal portion of the large intestine or the colon. And you can see a worm-like appendage right here, which is the appendix. And you often hear the appendix referred to as the vermiform appendix, and that's what vermiform means. It means worm-like. So this right here is going to be the appendix. On the right side, you will also have the ascending colon, particularly if it's easier to see, particularly if portions of the small intestine has been removed. Recall that this is going to be a secondarily retroperitoneal structure, so a bit more posteriorly placed. And where the ascending colon begins to make a sharp turn, this is going to be the right colic or hepatic flexure. It's named hepatic due to its close relationship with the liver. So anytime you see hepatic, think liver. The transverse colon does exactly what it sounds like. It runs transversely throughout the region, but occasionally it may extend into regions. As you can see with this individual, the transverse colon actually extends a bit superiorly. And as the transverse colon begins to turn distally or more inferiorly, you are getting into the left colic or splenic flexure due to its close relationship to the deeply located spleen. The descending colon descends on the left side of the body, and the sigmoid colon, which kind of begins right around this region here, is supposedly shaped like the Greek letter sigma, or you often hear of it as S-shaped. I say the sigmoid colon kind of does what it wants, but it is located in the left lower quadrant and certainly has some characteristic bends. And where you see the GI tract is beginning to straighten, then you know that you have reached the rectum. And the rectum actually tends to increase in caliber again, particularly when you reach the rectal ampulla, before there's a transition to the anal canal. But that's a little bit deeper in terms of the pelvic cavity region. So it's not really easy to see in this image, but you certainly can see a portion of the rectum here. All right, let's talk through a few unique characteristics of the large intestine. The tiny coli, or coli, which I'm outlining a portion of it here, it will extend throughout. There are actually three bands. This is composed of three bands of muscle that form the outer longitudinal layer of the muscularis. You can really only see one here, but it's going to run along. And this will actually send some small deviations of fibers throughout to form these circumferential bands around the large intestine. And this will create sacculations that are typically quite obvious. I can see a bit of one here. I can see one here. And these are referred to as hostra or hostration. Sometimes you'll see them just referred to as sacculations. Let me label the tiny coli as well. The hostrations represent sites where the mucosa and submucosa of the large intestinal wall are infolded, which will be visible internally as the semilunar folds, which we'll see in the next slide. These hostra, which you can just see throughout, are one of the most characteristic things about the large intestine to me. It's one of the things that I think is most obvious when you're looking at the large intestine. Additionally, throughout, you will see little pockets of what appears like fat throughout a good amount of the length of the large intestine. And I'm just labeling a few of these throughout. And these are referred to as the omental or the epiploic appendages. And these are, in fact, fat-filled outpouchings of the peritoneum. So three really characteristic things when we're talking about the large intestine. And lastly, as promised, let's look internally at the semilunar folds. I'm outlining some right here. These are going to be on the internal surface of the colon, and they're located in the place of the more externally visible hostra. So unlike the circular folds of the small intestine, the semilunar folds do not form complete rings. Excellent. That was a lot of viscera, and that isn't even all that can be found in the abdominal cavity. But hopefully you are feeling a bit more comfortable for most of the small and large intestine. Please take time to review and reach out if you have any questions. I hope you have a great rest of your day.